Oh, what a fabulous introduction. Thank you so, so much. I had a different segue into my reading here, but I'm just going to tell you a similar story. One day I'm sitting on the subway, and two girls come in. It's the middle of the afternoon. They're all, they've got a lot of jewelry on. They've got their little outfits on, and they are cutting high school. And they're sitting there, and it's kind of an empty car. And one of them looks at they're bored. They're cutting, but they're bored, you know. And one of them looks at the other and says, "Oh, let's do the poems." And they run up and down the subway car, and they find Dorothy Parker, go figure, and start memorizing the Dorothy Parker poem. And I say this in response to Scott. And his incredible project, which is a public project about literature, and in response to this week, this poetry festival, which is really quite extraordinary, and also brings poetry to many people who are just waking up to poetry. And so I'm knitting, and we just want to bring this around to thank Miles and Mimi, thank Susan and Lorraine, to thank my intern, Catherine, to thank my workshop. To thank Murder on the Beach, and to thank Mr. Wrigley, with whom I'm reading this evening, and of course, all of the spectacular poets who have read here and spoken here this week. It has been a joy to be among them. Now, why I'm not a Buddhist. I love desire. The state of want and thought of how to get. Building a kingdom in a soul requires desire. I love the things I sought. You in your beltless bathrobe. Tongues of cash that loll from my billfold. And love what I want. Clothes. Houses. Redemption. Can a new mold suit equal God? Oh no, desire is ranked. To lose a loved pen is not like losing faith. Acute desire for nut ghetto is driven out by death. But that cake on its plate has meaning. Even when love is endangered and nothing matters. For my mother, I would have wished for health. For my sister, bereft homes. But why is desire suffering? Because want leaves a world in tatters? How else but in tatters should a world be? A columned porch set high above a lake. Here, take my money. A loved face in agony, the spirit gone. Here, use my rags of love.
Thank you.
picked up from this afternoon. My favorite poem, one of my Kickstarter poems, Love 3 by George Herbert. I said something about how the sacred and the life of the appetite are coincident. I mean, you just scratch the sacred and food is not far behind. And sex, too. So here's a poem called Good Girl. There are a lot of good girls around here, so I thought I would read this poem for you, and there are good boys, too, so. And bad boys, bad girls. This is for everyone. It's an overgrown sonnet. This is just an aside to my workshop. It's sort of, a few too many hodgepodge Sundays. Hold up the universe, good girl. Hold up the tent that is the sky of your world at which you are the narrow center pole. Rupture is the enemy. Keep all whole. The itch to be yourself, plump and bending, below a sky unending, is denied by you as central control. Sever yourself, poor false Atlas, poor Atlas. Lie recumbent below the sky. Nothing falls down except you. Luscious and limited on the ground. Holding everything up, always on your own, creates a loneliness so profound. You are nothing but a column, good girl. A temple ruin against a sky held up by forces beyond you. So let yourself curl up. A fleshy fetal figure cupped about its own vibrant soul. You are the universe about its pole. And God's not far. Those two poems are from Cornucopia. And I'm going to do a little bit of a shout out. There are some marvelous poets in this audience who have come here for this reading this evening, and we're very honored to have you. I just want to shout out to Denise Duhamel. Also to Cindy Savett, a Philadelphia poet who is here this evening, and to Catherine Graham, who has attended this conference. She is a distinguished Canadian poet who has slipped among us without any ado, but I just want to give her a shout out too. She is a name that in any gathering of Canadian poets would spark. So I'm going to switch by some request from Denise's class to the second blush, and read you a poem in some ways about poetry, and then there we go. It's called The Cliffs of Mistake. To know
you're making a mistake. As you make it. Yet not be able to stop. Is to step off a cliff, expecting to scramble backward and up through the air to stand on the outcrop you stepped from, even though it can't unhappen as you backpedal wildly with the second step, looking far, far below onto the moraine of pain you anticipate later, which is now only the shock of recognizing the result there's no leaping back from. Oh, God! And this is only a metaphor. Might this be what metaphors are for? To say what it's like before you hit what it is.
Bravo.
Now it's time for audience participation. I'm going to read you, I've attempted to pull out of my work. I don't exclusively write in formal verse forms, but this is this is a sonnet guzzle. I mean, why not do it all? Right? But I'll just make a gesture when it's time for you to supply a phrase. Of night. A city mouse darts from the paws of night. A body drops from the jaws of night. A woman denies the laws of
night.
Awake and trapped in the was of
night.
A young man turns in the gauze of
night.
Unraveling the cause of
night.
That days extend their claws at
night.
To reenact old wars at
night.
Though dreams can heal old sores at
night.
And spring begins its thaw at
night.
While worry bones are gnawed at
night.
He sips her through a straw at
night.
Verbs whisper in the claws of
night.
A finger to her lips, the paws of
night.
Night. Oh, you did that, you. From the second blush. You don't, well, I don't know. I actually don't know about the other poets here, whether this is the case for them or not, but I have not stopped giving myself assignments, you know. And my assignment for the second blush was to write poems that spun on a single image. And I found that it was quite difficult. And as you can see about the night thing, I mean, that doesn't exactly spin on a single image. I failed much of the time. But when I thought about my marriage, I did have a thought of a single image. So this poem is called Marriage. Thank you for not laughing. often when I announce the title of that poem, but people think it's funny. I I watch my husband at a party. A shy boy become a man at ease at last. Success freshens his face. The boy now free to pass beneath his expressions as if slipping under a fence. I used to slip under a fence, to swim in a stream-fed pond, and laze in the water till shocked and delighted by a cold spot I swam through. That's what his face is like, infused by a source inside him. I know I have a part in it, just as I was part of the pond where I loved to swim. Do that thing that writers do that makes publishers wince. I'm going to read from a book that's not in the bookstore. It's not even published in the United States. It's a book that's only published in Canada, although a number of what is published in Canada is fiction, but published here in Barrow Street magazine, in Poetry magazine, as prose poems. So you'll decide what genre you think it is, and whether, as Scott said, I can have it all or not. This is from a book of illustrated fiction, and of course you can't see the illustrations, but they're collages, 21st century collages, and a little homage to Mary Delaney, the extraordinary collage artist I had the privilege of writing about in the paper garden. This is called Portrait of a Letter as a Young Bee. Every morning, the Fonts gathered for breakfast in the big house before strolling to the studios in the woods where they did their work. But Bee was brand new. Didn't understand that a font had to bustle in promptly to get the right seat at the right table. She came so late to breakfast on this breezy summer morning that there was no room with any of the other serif font groups. And no seats at any table of young fonts at all. B was left to beg the last spot at a table of elderly sans serif Lucida Grandes. Hey, a bimbo in our midst, an old grande said. He smiled shyly. Welcome to the colony. The long, large flowered curtains ballooned. At the other tables, the breakfast chatter was all about font shows, font magazines, font editions, and font awards, and where a sans serif had the best chance. But with the grandes, Bee calmly ate buttered bread, burnt bacon, and blackberries from a little bowl, recalling her grandmother's table. Some of the fonts at the older reject table, as Bee came to think of it, resented every new font from comic to zap. But others had a soft, dedicated glow. To entertain young Bimbo, those oldsters talked about their work on bees. They still liked forming better, best, and the babbling triple B words like bubble and bubble. Soon the whole table unabashedly hummed bubbles, bangles, bright shiny beads. After a few days, the groups were so completely formed that B never got to sit with her peers. Even if she arrived early, she knew that barging into someone else's chair created a displacement and forced the other font to sit with a blistering, bitter Times New Roman. As she had once had to do, Times sat at the far end table. In a single morning meal, B learned how he loved his bite like an acid sauna. His favorite words? Bilious and blight. B had barely thought about the honors for which Times so mordantly resented being ignored. How dare people call him B-list? He was the best. He deserved the Pulitzer, not to mention the Nobel Prize. After the ordeal of breakfast was over, B went to the press shop with relief. She spent the day becoming word after word, showing each its possibilities in a font like her, from a graceful old family, Bembo. She had yet to choose her favorite, but Brillig would be one of them. Gradually, Bee learned to love the old grande stories of the beggars in the roads who voluntarily gave up everything, all blathering, all bothering, all bamboozling. B would have liked to avoid those vices, but she had not yet learned to go only toward the positive. What she did learn that summer was to flee the negative. And she developed a Bembo prayer. Don't let me be like you. Don't let me be bitter. Don't let me break against the wrong words until I am bent and bruised. B was so young, she had yet to learn to love. Right then, she was learning to work. And the old benign rejected ones impressed her. Not much they had done was remembered anymore. But they were persevering at being, engaging themselves from Bramble to Beelzebub. Not to be bitter, Bembo prayed, and just to stay, to do what I do. So she bumbled for the rest of her summer. I've made it part of my life's work. I didn't know that it was going to be part of my life's work. To follow just those sorts of figures whom B comes to admire, their persistence, their having gone the distance in art. I honestly don't know how people process their lives without making art. And I think I share that with every single person in this auditorium. I don't know what I would do without having poetry with which to process my life, or without the challenge of that more complex art, as C. Scott was saying in the introduction of prose. I only came to prose, I came to prose long after I came to poetry. And I'm going to tell you a tiny story about Mrs. Delaney and close with two little poems. Mrs. Delaney, I know you all think that Picasso and Matisse invented collage in the 20th century, but let me tell you, there was a woman, okay, in 1772 who started, who invented botanical collage, and she was 72 years old. So here she started her life's work at that age. And it's absolutely, these collages are absolutely remarkable, and she did 985 of them in 10 years. I thought, who the hell is this woman? How did she do this? I mean, how do you invent an art form in your eighth decade? What happens earlier in your life that allows you the flexibility, the creativity, the imagination, not to mention the eye-hand coordination of doing this. And so I was able to track. I decided I'm going to track every instance of creativity I can find in her life. Luckily, she left thousands of pages of letters, so it wasn't so hard to do. It took a long time. I share this with you because many people have the seeds of art in their childhoods. Everyone here, of course, was an imaginative child. We all were imaginative children. And then certain things happen that allow people to choose the path of art immediately. And other things conspire for people to delay the path of art. Sometimes for many decades. The first sentence, I don't have the book with me because I came here as a poet, and I didn't think of myself as coming here as a prose writer, but then there's this fantastic introduction, and several people came up to me saying, oh, I'm so overloaded with poetry, I was glad to read one of your paragraphs. So there she was, and she was in a state of deep mourning. She lost her second husband, her first husband, we won't talk about. Her grandfather's age, you know, she was born more or less sold to him by her father when she was 17. It was a terrible 18th century situation. But she was 68 when finally her beloved second husband died, and she was sitting, she was totally disoriented for years. And you would watch her handwriting disintegrate. And then her friend said, come and walk in this garden with me. So she's walking in the garden, and she doesn't have a great experience. She got stung on the foot by a gnat. Her foot swells up to three times its size. They put her in a chair. They put all of her quote-unquote amusements around her. Her embroidery scissors, her floss, her silhouette paper. She cut out silhouettes. Some wallpaper that her friend had been collecting, and a plant, a geranium, which was a very expensive, colossally expensive in that day. And she had a moment of enforced stillness. I invite all of you to think of the last moment of stillness in your life. Something we try to cultivate, we can't write without it. But it's hard to garner. But she was forced, and she observed a red petal detach itself from the geranium and slowly drift to the darkened surface of the table below. And in unconscious, automatic, physical response, she picked up her scissors. Saw a piece of wallpaper the same color as the geranium and cut out a petal. And then she cut out another one. And then she cut out another one. And another. in the trance-like repetition of her imagination. Snip. That was the origin of an entire art form. And that is one of the few recorded instances we have of how someone began an art form. And I just invite you to think about it, and invite you to think about your own lives and those moments in your own lives that you can bring to bear on your own poetry. And I talked away one of my two poems, so I'm only going to conclude with one. Sorry. And not only that, it's not one of the ones I planned. Because everybody knows, I mean, you can tell, right? Like I had a plan. But then something happens in a room, and it's different than what you anticipated when you were in your hotel room. So I thought I better read it going out. Little miracle. Oh, there's a little word in here, coracle. If Maureen Ford was still here, she could have told us what this is. There are fishermen here. So it's a little fishing boat. Where it's clear that it's a little Irish fishing boat where the ribs of the boat are very obvious. Little miracle. No use getting hysterical. The important part is we're here. Our lives are a little miracle. My hummingbird-hearted schedule beats its shiny frenzy day into year. No use getting hysterical. It's always like that. The oracle a human voice could be is shrunk by fear. Our lives are a little miracle. We must remind ourselves. Whimsical and lyrical and large and slow and clear, so no use getting hysterical. All words other than I love you are clerical, dispensable, and replaceable, my dear. Our inner lives are a miracle. They beat their essence in the coracle our ribs provide. The watertight boat we steer through others' acid, hysterical demands. Ours is the miracle. We're here. Thank you very much.